flame is there. Use your imagination.
The light of Christ is in our midst. And if we were Pentecost, you could see it off of each one of your heads as you exude the love of God. So welcome to Zwingli United Church of Christ in Monticello. Paul?
Well, good morning. Well, today is 4 February 2024. And welcome to Zwingli United Church of Christ. My name is Paul Reeder, and I am your lay liturgist for today. As far as announcements go, today is Pastor Ted's last Sunday as our interim minister. Yes, I agree. I've heard nothing but good things about Ted, and he served us well and faithfully and joyfully, and we say goodbye to him today at a special time during social hour. And social hour will be after worship in Fellowship Hall. So come down, join us, and say your last goodbye to Ted. Now, it's not going to be truly goodbye. I understand he will probably still be a pulpit supply, and we may need pulpit supply in the future. And I'm sure he would answer the call if he's available and we asked. So, thank you, Ted. I see in my notes that today is Blanket Sunday. And we have envelopes out in the narthex and on our east entrance. And you're invited to leave a donation for blankets through Church World Service. A blanket is $10, and the Blanket Sunday is very special to me. I served as the mission coordinator for 12 years after I got out of the Air Force, and I was talking with our pastor then, who's sitting right down there, Pastor Blaine, many years ago. We talked about blankets and how important they were, and we came up with an idea. He said to me, he says, Paul, I think if during the time I've been here, we took all the blankets and we laid them end to end, they'd probably go from here to New Glarus. It's about 5 miles. And so what I did was I calculated the money that we had donated over that time. And I realized, yes, it would go to New Glarus, but let's go the other way. And so for the next few, so towards Monroe. So what we did was we did a campaign over several years, and using Google Earth, I projected the blankets that we gave would reach from our doorstep all the way out to Highway 69 south, across Bergey Flats, up the hill by Cold Springs Farm, and down the other side. And we had a little flyby, and in the time that I served, we laid blankets end-to-end from here to the square in Monroe, 12 miles. We've always done well with blankets. Blankets are like giving a hug to somebody in need. So I say rather than Blanket Sunday, this should be Blanket Month. So if you don't give today, give next week and the week after. So Blanket Sunday. Think about that. They're $10. If you write a check, write it to Zwingli United Church of Christ. In the memo section, put blankets, and that will be put into the fund that we send to Church World Service. So thank you for that. Next Sunday, of course, is Super Bowl. And there's soup in Super Bowl. Yeah, traditionally what we do during Super Bowl Sunday is we donate soup for the local food pantry. So next Sunday is Super Bowl Sunday, and remember that there is soup in Super Bowl. Also, next Sunday, the Brotherhood is going to put on a pancake breakfast. It's kind of an early Shrove Tuesday on Sunday. So a breakfast will be served after church, 10:30 till noon in Fellowship Hall. serving the Brotherhood's famous pancake sausage, applesauce, maple syrup. I think is we still have, probably Johnny will be bringing some of his homemade maple syrup, and there'll be a beverage with a free will donation. We ask for prayers for the family of and friends of Patricia Plus, who passed this week. Visitation is here at Zwingli and will be from 10 to 11:30 on Tuesday. Her memorial service follows at 11:30. As far as joys, other joys and concerns, just talking with Sam and Carol Powell, they will be celebrating their 63rd anniversary. February 9th, yes. Okay, that's all I have. Passing of the peace.
Wait, Nancy. Oh, please do.
Good morning. Most of you might be aware that I have the honor of serving as our church treasurer now. One of the things that also gives me is a greater opportunity to make even more mistakes. So if your statements that came out, if we had your permission in the past for an email for us to email your statements, those went out on Friday, so hopefully you received them. And then whoever I don't catch today, I'm going to stamp sticker them and put them in the mail. But I did find out from someone today, if you try to respond to the email that went out with your statement, it will bounce back. So if you have questions, please find me. Because trying to answer that email, evidently it won't. Thank you.
So if you're... Yep. Carol. Eldon Sherman's birthday. Happy birthday. Do we sing happy birthday here? Is that something we do? We got six hands. I could ask you how many years young you are, but I'm not going to. So if you want to know, come to the coffee hour, and he'd be happy to share birthday cake down there for you also. I know many of you are aware that we've been on baby watch family, and my daughter did have a baby this past week, and we have a new little granddaughter, Paisley. And so we're very excited. About Paisley, I get to go see her this afternoon, so and hold her. So we're very excited. So, per it being flu season and everything else, we're going to stay for the passing of the peace, and we're also going to stay in seats when we lay hands on the consistory. So we'll kind of go this kind of a thing when we do that part too, just kind of a forewarning. So let us stand and greet our neighbors in our seats with the love of God and pass the peace. The Lord be with you.
Please join me in a responsive call to worship. Come, all who are poor in spirit. Come, all who mourn. Come, all who are meek. Come, all who are hungry and thirst after righteousness. Come, all who would be merciful. Come, all who would be pure in heart. Come, all who would be peacemakers. Let us come together, the weak, the simple, the powerless, and foolish. Let us confess that the source of our life is Christ Jesus. Let us worship the God of our blessing. All who are able, please stand for hymn number 111, When Morning Gilds the Skies.
Let us pray. God of heaven and earth, we who bind ourselves to this world seek a vision beyond ourselves and our immediate circumstances. Direct our thoughts towards the marvels of your creation and the vast possibilities that you have placed within us. Gather us to yourself and link us to one another in ways that will build up your church and empower our service. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please be seated. Affirmation of gifts, talents, and leadership is an act whereby a local church of the United Church of Christ recognizes the diverse gifts of those serving in leadership in the church. Today we celebrate the particular ministry of each person in the life of the church, or in various settings in the life of the world. There are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit gives them. There are different ways of serving, but the same God is served. There are different abilities to perform service, but the same God gives ability to each of us for our particular service. The Spirit's presence is shown in some way in each person for the good of all. Christ is like a single body which has many parts. It is still one body, even though it is made up of different parts. If one part of the body suffers, all the other parts suffer with it. If one part is praised, all the other parts share its happiness. All of us are Christ's body, and each one is part of it. I'd like to ask the 2023 consistory to please come forward. You kind of know who you are. Come on up. You can stand next to me. Okay, I'm on the end. You get to be right there, and you're going to stay for a while. These people have been called by God in accordance with the faith and order of this church to serve in leadership roles among us. They have accepted their call and are before us in witness to their willingness to serve. I would first like to recognize the following people who have served us in making the day-to-day decisions of our church, the consistory. We have Sherry Wixer and Barb Plus. Those are the two that are going to be going off the consistory for a brief moment. Right? That's what it says in the script. And we like to thank you for the time and effort you have given us. We thank you for setting the tone for those who follow in your roles as leaders. Today, with sadness, we release you from your duties as consistory members, knowing that you will continue to be vibrant and working members of this congregation. Sherry and Barb, thank you so much for all the work you have done. Okay, you guys get to go back to your seats. The rest of you get to stay up here. So I'd like to ask Nicole Tim, and is Erica Apple Wiesenberg here? I think she might not be here. Okay. So I'd like to introduce the new members of our consistory, Chuck Anderson, Nicole Tim, and you all know Erica Apple Wiesenberg, who is not present with us at this moment. We welcome these folks to serve as our governing body for the coming year. That includes the middle three of you, too. By the way, just not two end members. So I would like to share our covenant. Sisters and brothers in Christ, it is an honor to be entrusted with responsibility for a particular service in the ministry of the church, whether gathered or scattered. Having prayerfully considered the duties and responsibilities of your ministry, are you, the 2024 consistory, prepared to serve with the help of God in Christ's name for the glory of God? If so, please say, I am. Do you promise to exercise your ministry diligently and faithfully, showing forth the love of Christ? If so, please say, I do, relying on God's grace. Let us, the members of Zwingli United Church of Christ, join together in one voice members of this household of faith, you have heard the promises of our brothers and sisters in Christ who have answered God's call to service. Let us affirm our intention to live in covenant with them. Will those of you able to rise and witness to the commitment, please, they may please rise. We gather in celebration of the joy that is ours to be partners with you in the service of Jesus Christ. You have the honor your leadership and assist you with Jesus Christ. Why don't we all get to hold our hands out, because we're laying hands on these folks. I'm going to stand in the middle, and I want each one of you guys to actually just stand a little closer. I know that's probably against all the code in every other rule in the world, but anyway. So let us pray and lay hands upon our 2024 consistory. May the Holy Spirit strengthen you for ministry of the consistory members in this church, and equip you with every good to do God's will. Receive authority to execute this office. We ask this in the name of Christ. Let all the people say, Amen. You may be seated. I don't think you guys can yet. No, Chuck, you gotta, no, sorry. That was for them out there. I know. Oh, it's such a burden. You wanna preach?
No.
Okay. Just asking. Let us pray. Eternal God, you have called these people to serve you in this household of faith and in the world, which you have entrusted to our care and keeping. Send your Holy Spirit on them that they may serve among us with honor and faithfulness. Help them to be diligent in their duties, that your church may prosper in the mission you placed before it. May their example prove worthy for all of us to follow as we are united in Christ's ministry to the glory of your name. Let all the people say, Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, and on behalf of the members of Zwingli United Church of Christ, I rejoice to present to you your 2024 consistory. So I kind of remind you, this is kind of a dumb thing to say, but you know, they're your consistory, so stay in touch. If you have questions, talk to them, ask them. If you have suggestions, talk to them, ask them. If you have a burning desire in your heart, or even a small one, to do part of the ministry of Zwingli, call them, because they would love to hear from all of us, because together we are the body of Christ and each individual members of it. It takes a community. It takes all of us to do the ministry of Zwingli UCC. So thank you, guys, and have a blessed year as the consistory. And thank you. You can sit down now, John. Okay. Thanks. And let us rise and sing hymn number 603, In Christ There Is No East or West.
Oh,
Lucille.
I'm at the invocation. Oh, well, Corinthians. Okay. Our epistle lesson for today comes from Corinthians chapter 9, verses 16 through 23. For when I preach the gospel, I cannot boast, since I am compelled to preach. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. If I preach voluntarily, I have a reward. If not voluntarily, I am simply discharging the trust committed to me. What then is my reward? Just this, that in preaching the gospel, I may offer it free of charge, and so not make full use of my rights as a preacher of the gospel. Though I am free and belong to no one, I have made myself a slave to everyone, to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I become like a Jew, to win the Jews. To those under the law, I become like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I become like one not having the law. Though I am not free from God's law, but under Christ's law, so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I become weak. To win the weak, I become all things to all people, so that by all possible means I might save some. I do this for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessing. And our gospel message for today comes from Mark, chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the house of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they immediately told Jesus about her. So they went to her, took her hand, and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. That evening after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but he would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him, and when they found him, they explained, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else to the nearby villages so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. So ends the reading of our scriptures.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This morning's message is about the reason for the incarnation. So at one level, you can stop listening now. I've said it all. It's really about, you know, I've said this before, but I really think it's true. It's really God's love story, right? It's God's love story for each and every one of us. And it's how God says to each and every one of us, I am so smitten with you and love you so much. So in this, you know, way of thinking about it, we're going to think about God as incarnate, material, human, here on earth, part of our lived experience, you know, this kind of stuff. And the question is why? And there's a lot of answers to that question. And some are more satisfying than others, depending on kind of where we are in our faith journey. But today I want to think about this seemingly little, funny little healing story of Jesus healing Simon's mother-in-law. P.C. Enos, a theologian, when he talked about this healing, said, Jesus' understanding seems compatible with our contemporary understanding of illness as unwholeness, or, you know, this is not part of the quote, or what we would call dis-ease, right? Disease, dis-ease. Okay, now we're back to the quote. And of healing as the bringing about of wholeness. So our understanding of illness as unwholeness, and healing as bringing us back to wholeness. After all, what's the point of modern medicine but to heal people and to make them more whole? As religious people, we think of wholeness not only as physical wholeness, but we also remember that our wholeness is not only physical, but also emotional and spiritual also. For many of us, we admit that a person can be whole, still be physically ill, because their mind and spirit are in the right place. We might think of hospice, you know. I think it was Kubler-Ross said, very loosely translated, you know, many are healed, but all die. And many are healed in hospice, even though they also die. So Jesus brings to Simon's mother-in-law salvation, salvus, healing. How did he do this? No, we didn't say the right incantation or do the exactly right words. He merely took her hand and lifted her up. All he did was touch her. Kind of a little parenthesis. We might remember the story of the woman who had been hemorrhaging for 12 years old. 12 years. You think, what did she want? All she needed to do was touch the hem of his cloak. All she needed to do was touch him. And in this situation, Jesus takes her hand and lifts her up. It's amazing the power of physical touch. And I have to, you know, all these little parentheses today. But anyway, you know, we do kind of have to remember appropriate boundaries and appropriate touch and all that kind of stuff. So we're thinking about it in relationship to being helpful and appropriate, of course. And we think of it in relationship to the healing arts, you know, massage, Reiki. Healing touch, and like today, the laying on of hands is also incredibly powerful and all involve physical touch. The power of touch is often overlooked. We're connectional animals. We need to know, I think, a visceral level, that we are deeply connected. You know, like I said, my daughter just had a baby. She's all of a week old, not even. Can you hold a baby too much? If you put them down, they don't thrive, right? If you hold them, they thrive. Now, go into a nursing home. How many of those people get touched, held, you know, even a handshake? I love those situations where you have the little kids going into the be with the old folks. And what do you see when I see those things on the news? You see the grandmas and grandpas hugging them, hugging up the little kids. You can't help but to hug up the little kids. And it's good for everybody. And those little kids don't know any different. They'll just hug you up and touch you, and everybody benefits from that. We all need that. I think the prescription for a healthy life is what? 8 hugs a day. I think we all need about 8 hugs a day. And what is it about physical nurturing and contact? It shows intimacy, nearness, love, care, connection. It shows we're not alone, and we're not in it alone. We're connected to something much bigger than ourselves. Touch, love, intimacy, connection shows the nearness that we crave so much. You know, for me to take care of my 11-month-old grandson, at one point, they're like, you know, he was really little, he can't kiss the baby. He's like, how could you not, like, hug up your little grandson? And he's got the big chubby cheeks and the whole 9 yards. It's just so wonderful for my soul. I think Jesus understood this very basic thing. Love not expressed, love not felt, is difficult to trust. It's so basic that we can forget that love needs to be expressed. And love is one of those things, the more you give it away, the more you get. If you try to hold on to it and protect it, poof, vanishes, goes away, not there. If you are extravagant in your loving, you just get filled up with it more and more. Love has to be expressed. And that love that's expressed and felt is trusted. How do we express it? Not only in words, but also in our actions. God knows this about us because it's the way God made us. That humans need nearness, connection, touch. As P.C. Enos continues to write, he says, Jesus is the incarnation of God's love, which makes it all the more demanding, if not frightening, to realize that for some people, we are the only Jesus they will ever meet. Remember, we are the body of Christ. We are the incarnation. Jesus is the incarnation of God, but we are the incarnation too. And we may be the only Jesus that someone can meet. We're the Jesus that hugs them and holds them and tells them just how much we love them. Yes, that happens in prayer. But sometimes prayer happens at coffee, or over the dinner table, or when you're reading the bedtime story, all those things. We may be the only Jesus someone else meets. We bring this wholeness through community and through the love of community and the way that community can heal. Love comes not only from people, but through people. but also among us. And we feel that connection, and it helps pull people together. God becomes material and human because we are creatures of connection, and we are creatures that need nearness. God gives us nearness in community, in each other, and we are not alone. God is with us. No wonder at Advent we often talk about Jesus being called Emmanuel, God with us. I want to close with a little healing story, which I think is important and really quite sweet. Another physician, Richard Sulzer, had written of the miracle of touch, and he writes, "I stand by the bed where a young woman lies, her face post-operative, her mouth twisted, palsy, clownish. A teeny twig of the facial nerve, the one to the muscle of her mouth, was severed, had to be severed, to remove the tumor in her cheek. I had cut that little nerve. The young husband is in the room. He stands on the opposite side of the bed, and together they seem to dwell in the evening lamplight, isolated from me, private. Will my mouth always be like this?" she asks. "Yes," I said, "it will." "It's because the nerve was cut." She nods and is silent. The young man smiles. "I like it," he says. "It's kind of cute." He bends to kiss her crooked mouth. And I am so close that I can see how he twists his own lips to accommodate her, to show her that their kiss still works. I hold my breath and let the wonder in." Amen. Let us rise and sing our next hymn, which I can't remember what it is. There's a balm in Gilead. Please be seated. Let us pray. I breathe in. I breathe out. I breathe in God's tremendous love. And God says to each one of us, I love you. I breathe out my response to that love, which is, I love you. I love you. I love you. In this response, our destinies fulfill. In this reciprocity of love, we are taken to heaven. God says to each one, I love you. God's love is beyond our imagination. God's desire for each and every one of us is for wholeness. We pray for those who feel broken, for those who mourn, especially the Plus family. For those who are missing family members like the Trumpies. For those who just feel pushed down by life, whether it's abusive relationships, whether it's just not feeling good about oneself, whether it's working so hard to make it, and yet just don't earn enough to make it. For those who struggle to take care of their families and the burden is so challenging, the stress and the strain. Sometimes we snap. For those who struggle with almost all of us, with mental illness of one kind or another. For those who struggle just to get out of bed in the morning. We pray for those who are unemployed and underemployed. We pray for those that are refugees, whether it's because of climate change or war or famine or whatever. We pray for those places that seem really far off, yet are around the corner, that are torn by war and hatred. For the situations that, and things we tell each other that try to divide and create deeper divisions. God, help unite us, not only as the United States, but also as the one human family all across the world. For creatures that are on this planet, and it's not that we're on the planet, we're part of the whole ecosystem. It's a living, breathing entity, this planet that we are part of. Help us care, do our part to care for this one-time gift of the earth. Be with all of us and help us to find ways that we can be and are Christ for another, that others may look into our eyes and unbeknownst to us, they see Jesus looking back, loving them holding them and they feel healed. And we know nothing about it. We ask all these things and all which dwells in our heart in the name and spirit of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'd like to thank each and every one of you for your gifts and your offerings that help make Zwingli UCC do its ministry. For those of you who have given here and those of you who are online, you can donate at our website. So thank you for all of that. The gospel is freely given for the nurture and salvation. In gratitude, we share the good news with others. Through our offerings and our rededication of life to God's purposes, let us join together in celebration of our giving, and let us rise and respond to our giving. Praise Christ, all creatures here before. And let us join together with our prayer of thanksgiving. With these gifts, we give thanks for the relief from slavery to the world's agenda. In awe and wonder, we commit ourselves anew to the ministry of hope and healing that Jesus lived on earth. Use our offerings to extend Christ's mission where we cannot go, and to support this congregation in our efforts to be faithful where we are. Amen. Let us join together in one voice singing, Pass It On. Thank you. A quick reminder that many of you who want your offering reports, see Nancy before you leave this morning. And I also like to thank you to everybody for this opportunity for me to serve. It's been a wonderful experience for me. The generosity of Zwingli in Monticello has been overwhelming. I have really found this to be a wonderful opportunity for discernment, and I'm going to more permanently take my title, pastor, and kind of dust it off and put it on the shelf and put it in a little box, because I've got a new title. It's grandparent. And that is the one we're going to learn to live into more deeply, and the one that will give also opportunity to serve God in many ways. So let us receive God's blessing. Remember this, brothers and sisters, God gives faith forever. Go from this place to share God's love, to pronounce and be the Christ for the other, and maybe somehow, if you get anxious or worried or concerned this week, remember that the wondrous love of God, the healing power of Christ Jesus, and the bold courage of the Holy Spirit is with you today and every day. Amen.